Nourished to the last week of the month of Rajab, just wanted to emphasize the importance of maximizing the benefit of these blessings of the month of Rajab. If you look at the Islamic calendar, as I have explained this many times, just as a reminder, that we can divide the beginning of the year according to different activities. You have a fiscal year, you have an academic year, at the beginning of the calendar, the first month of the year. If you look at the beginning of the spiritual season, Rajab is the beginning. Starts with Rajab, you get into Sha'ban, and you reach to the peak in the month of Ramadan. So these 3 months are actually the spiritual season in the Islamic calendar. As far as the month of Rajab is concerned, historically it's also a month which is filled with events related to the Prophet and his Ahlul Bayt. On the Tuesday of coming week will be the 27th of the month of Rajab. And that is the anniversary of the beginning of the Wahi and the revelation of the Quran in the cave of Hira to our Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It also is anniversary of the famous event in the life of the Prophet, which is known as Isra and Mi'raj, the ascension of the Prophet to the heavens. And therefore, that is considered to be a very important day, even from the religious point of view. It is highly recommended to fast on that day. Of course, those who have qaza fast, they have to make sure they do the niyat of qaza on that day. Remember, when it comes to nafila prayers, you can do it even though you have wajib namaz, which are qaza. But when it comes to fasting, the ruling is that if you want to do a sunnat fast, then you have to do the niyat of qaza. You can't do the niyat of sunnat. But to fast on that day is very, very highly recommended. That one day's fasting, as far as the reward is concerned, it is equal to fasting for 60 years. I'm emphasizing this is just equal in reward. Not in our calculation that I've already fasted for 60 years. No. And we see that this month, basically, it's a month where, especially on that day of 27th, it's not only the fasting which is highly recommended, the issue of sadaqah also. You know, to help those who are needy and poor is also very highly recommended. And it's also recommended that on that day, make the mu'mineen happy. You know, so we had to make sure we don't do anything which will hurt any mu'min or a mu'mina. As far as the events are concerned, you know, there are so many events. We have been going through the programs during this month. We also have events coming on the weekend and even after that. Also, the marriage of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Fatima al-Zahra took place. In the month of Rajab. But let me talk about an event which took place on the 15th of Rajab in the second year of the Hijrah. And that has to do with the issue of changing of the Qibla. As we know that Namaz started in Makkah. Initially, it was only two rakats. Then the two rakats for Zuhur and Asr and one for Maghrib and two for Isha were added later on, of course, by the command of Allah and instruction of the Prophet. And when the Prophet and the Muslims used to do the prayers in Mecca, for them, the Qibla was not Kaaba. When they were there in Mecca, their Qibla was Al-Quds, Jerusalem. And even after Hijrat, when the Prophet migrated to Medina, for the first 2 years, year and few months, the Qibla was still Jerusalem. The difference here was that there was a sizable Jewish minority in Medina, and some of them used to make, you know, remarks to the Muslims, you know, your religion is not independent, you guys are following our Qibla. And these remarks reached to even Rasulullah, and he felt kind of hurt. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then, you know, describes the scenario of the anxiety that the Prophet was going through because of this. And he wouldn't really say much. But according to Surah Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ, that, O Muhammad, we see your face turning towards the heavens, as if pleading, oh Allah, get me out of this. I don't want to have this taunting on me and my religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, he is the most beloved prophet. And so he assures him, وَلِنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا, very soon, O Muhammad, we are going to change your Qibla to the Qibla that you like. You know, look at the language. You know, it is him pleading here, Habib. And the Mahbub says, I know, and very soon I'm going to change, not just the Qibla, but the Qibla that you will like. And that's where we see that in the second year of the Hijrah, on the 15th of Rajab, while the Prophet was in a masjid in Medina, leading the prayers. This is interesting. You know, this command could have come before it or after it. But right in the middle of the masjid, you know, the command comes in. فَوَلِّ وَجْهِكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. The initial command is addressed to the Prophet individually. فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ, turn your face. Here, your is in a singular form, not in a plural. وَجْهَكَ, your face, towards Masjidul Haram. Means changing of Qibla was, in the first place, a personal favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the ayat goes on, وَحَيْسُمَا كُنْتُمْ قُولْ فَوَلَّوْ وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَةً. And O Muslims, wherever you are, at the time of prayers, turn your faces towards Masjid al-Haram. So it was on 15th of Rajab, second year of the Hijrah, that the Qibla changes from Jerusalem towards Mecca, from Al-Quds towards Masjid al-Haram. Why in the Namaz? You can just imagine the scenario, you know. Rasulullah right in the middle of the Namaz is right there in the front, turns opposite. Maybe many would have been very confused. And this is not a blame for everyone there. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الْقِبْلَ الَّتِي كُنْتَ عَلَيْهَا إِلَّا لِتَعْلَمَ مَنْ يَطَّبِعَ الرَّسُولِ مِمَّنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ أَقِيبِهِ. That this changing of the Qibla was just to test the people. Are they in absolute obedience of you or not? You know, because people sometimes say, you know, it doesn't make sense. Why? What did he do? We were doing this way, now we are doing this way. Our duty to Rasulullah is just to obey. You can go and ask that question later on. When it comes to the action, there is nothing but ittiba and ita'at, obedience, nothing else. And so you can imagine the scenario now. Rasulullah is at the end, and people in the front, when they turn around, and people when they hear the story, some of them say, Masalam, Maulana, but how can it be the Imam of Jamaat is at the end? Well, that's a normal rule. They are exception to situations. This was a very extraordinary event, and it happened. Those who go for Umrah and Hajj, when you go to Medina, you go to a masjid known as Masjid Zul Qiblatain, the Masjid of two Qiblas. This is where the Qibla was changed. One of the things about this change of the Qibla is actually, that itself, that action by the Prophet was a miracle. Because when we build a place as a masjid and we are looking for the direction, you know, we always look at these days, of course, we have computers and this and that. You look at the compass, or you go out and look in the sun, try to figure it out, you know, what would be the right direction. There Rasulullah is right in the middle of the namaz. Look at the map. Medina is right in the middle. Makkah is in the south of Medina. And Jerusalem is right on the north of Medina. So it's completely opposite. He doesn't wait there and, you know, stop the namaz. Can somebody bring a compass? Or bring some of those who are expert in, you know, astronomy? Let us find the direction from Medina to Mecca. Right in the middle of the namaz, without even interrupting his namaz, he turns. And this is where the people who think he is ummi, doesn't know much, you know, this is where you have to realize that even the turning of the Qibla itself was a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without using any expertise or tools, Rasulullah turns from Al-Quds towards Masjid-ul-Haraam. Salawat upon you. Allama Tabatabai in his Tafsir al-Mizan talks about it, where he says that for a long time, some of the Muslim scientists who are expert in astronomy, they used to debate this whole issue that the Qibla would change in Medina from Jerusalem to Masjid al-Haram. It's not exactly the true direction, because they were using their own standards and tools that they had at that time. Then Allama Tabatabai says, only recently, about a century ago, when they started using even more refined and advanced tools, and when they looked at the Qibla, the way it changed, now they know that the way Rasulullah turned was exactly the true direction from Medina towards Masjid al-Haram. And that is why we believe that this action itself was a miracle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salawat. Inna ahsan al-hadith kitab Allah al-Aziz, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr, illa al-lazina amanu wa amil al-salihat, wa tawasaw bil-haqqi, wa tawasaw bil-sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف العباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الضعين على سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. Talking about the Kaaba, one of the symbols of unity of Muslims on a global level is the Kaaba. Some people have done a study, I haven't really verified it as such, but it's not difficult to you know, think of its possibility, where they say, if you are looking at the earth from the space, and if you are able to trace a line from the people who are standing in their salat towards the Kaaba, it is because of the movement of the earth, and because of the timing, every moment there would be a point on the earth where it is the time for Salat. So at every moment there will be line, if you can draw a line from the people who are doing the Salat to the Kaaba, you will see there is a connection established all the time. There is not a moment on the earth which would be away from that connection. And it's amazing, in spite of all the differences that we have among the Muslims, when it comes to the central position of the Kaaba, the sanctity of the Kaaba, it is still there, accepted by all. Whether we are Shia or Sunni or Sufi or Wahhabi or whatever, when it comes to this time of Salat, our Qibla is the Kaaba. Qibla basically is the direction where you face. And Kaaba is the point. The Qibla before the second year of the Hijrah was Al-Quds. And then it changed towards Kaaba. And there is a very interesting, when we look at this event happening in the month of Rajab, which is also the month of Ali ibn Abi Talib. That symbolism is really, you know, something we cannot ignore. Because there is a hadith from Amir al-Mu'minin himself, quoted by Sheikh Mufid. He says, Rajab shahri wa sha'ban shahru Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَرَمَضَانْ شَهْرُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. If you remember, I mentioned in the first khutbah that these 3 months, Rajab, Sha'ban, Ramadan, are the spiritual season in our calendar. It's very interesting the way Ali divides these 3 months. He says, Rajab is my month, Sha'ban is month of Rasulullah, and Ramadan is the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have to go to Rasul, you have to go through Ali. First you come to Ali, then you reach to Rasulullah, and from Rasulullah you reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we look at the Kaaba itself, you know, this symbolism, that why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decide that the birth of Amir al-Mu'minin would be in the Kaaba itself? Even the whole process of purifying the Kaaba in Fath Makkah was done by Ali. Purification, in a sense, getting rid of the idols which had been placed over it and inside it. And this is where, you know, if you really think about it on a long-term basis, that Ali is somebody who was born in Baytullah. And he was attacked in the masjid. And in between, when he was in Medina, his house was inside Masjid-ul-Haraam. There was a time when the hukum of taharat and najasat of the masjid came down. The houses of many relatives and companions with the doors facing inside the sahan of masjid were closed. Rasulullah said, only leave my door and the door of Ali and Fatima open. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, all this symbolism in themselves are very important. Somebody who was born in the house of Allah, who was killed in the house of Allah, and who spent many, many years of his life in a house where the door opened into the sahan of Masjid al-Nabi itself. And this is where, you know, people can run away from Ali. But when they go for a hajj, when they go and do the tawaf of the Kaaba, if they know anything of history, they will be forced to remember that this is not only the Baytullah, this is also the birthplace of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wassalam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the place of symbolism in the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to try in our actions and deeds and in our words, you know, to be the true followers of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad salawatullah alayhi majma'in. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. وعلى إمام المتقين وعمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها. وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما أحيا آثار البدو والطغيان حادمي أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فرو البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.